After the first atomic bomb, Einstein said, "If I had known where this would lead, I'd have been a watchmaker."
Hi, I'm CB Smith, and we're going to be talking about Frankenstein Unbound, both the movie and the book that it's based on. This was a hard one. Brian Aldiss was part of the new wave of science fiction that was popping up in the 1960s and 70s. The focus on this era of science fiction was not on trying to explain the science used in the stories, or using the science to tell adventure stories in a new setting that was more prominent in the golden age of sci-fi. New Wave was more focused on exploring introspection, political, or philosophical ideas. Usually in these stories, the science is handled sloppily and used more as a vehicle to tell more personal stories. In a way, New Wave science fiction had more in common with the first science fiction stories written than the Golden Age did. Stories like 300 Years Hence by Mary Griffith, published in 1836, didn't care how the character traveled through time to 2136. More, the author just wanted to lecture her audience on how the world would be better off if slavery ended and women were treated equal to men. That brings us to Mary Shelley and Frankenstein, where I spent the last two videos talking about how there isn't much science in her work, but the focus is more so on the pursuit of science and how you should not lose your humanity in doing so. Also not give birth to a life and run away and have it fend for itself, just maybe. Now we have Frankenstein Unbound, written by Aldiss in 1973. It begins in the far-off year of 2020.
Oh no.
Where the main character Joe Bodolin is writing a letter to his wife Mina, hoping the post office still works after government interference.
Oh no.
Joe was a presidential advisor kicked out of the administration for pushing police and housing reforms due to civil unrest.
Oh no.
And a recent exchange of nuclear arms in the atmosphere caused a ripple in time and space.
Oh, wait a minute. That didn't happen yet. Oh god, there's still time, isn't there?
It's kind of fun sometimes reading these older sci-fi stories and see what people imagine the future would be like. I mean, Mark Twain predicted internet streaming in 1898, but he was just a couple years off of that prediction. The movie adaptation for Frankenstein Unbound, made in 1990, moved a year up to 2031, and instead of nuclear weapons, the cause for the rip in time and space, it was Joe, whom in the movie is a scientist experimenting with creating miniature black holes as a weapon for the government. My guess is that since the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty of 1987 and the fall of the Soviet Union less than a year after this movie comes out, the threat of nuclear bombs was nowhere near as prominent as when the novel was published back in 1973. So a new reason was made for the slips in time, appropriately named time slips. In the movie, Joe finds a group of kids holding a funeral in his front yard for a bicycle, which is accurate to the book, in which Joe is inside looking on at his grandkids making a mock funeral for a bike.
In the world of Frankenstein Unbound, the book, religion is not non-existent, but it's not the norm anymore, so something like funerals is like a game that kids would play. Kind of like how trick-or-treating for Halloween has roots dating back to the 15th century, where children and poor people would go to houses and pray and collect soul cakes. Some countries still have this tradition in some form, but it definitely fallen on the wayside.
But who cares about historical trivia? A time slip happens in front of the house and brings out a Hun warrior on horseback to the present, future, and attacks Joe. Something like this does happen in the book, where Joe and his whole house is transported to medieval Europe and is attacked by a knight. But he is sent back to his time within a day. Another time slip takes him to an unknown field, thinking he has time. Joe takes his car to drive around, in an unknown place and time period that probably has never seen a car before. Joe hides his car away, and in the book he just decides to go to sleep at a nearby inn.
In the case for Joe, I guess you can say he got into a bit of a mind flip.
You're into the time slip!
At the inn, Joe finds out he's in Geneva, Switzerland in 1816, after meeting and having a conversation with Victor Frankenstein, and later in the story, Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin, not yet married to her future husband Percy Shelley. In the world of Frankenstein Unbound, Victor Frankenstein is both a literary character in one of the first and most influential science fiction stories in the world, but is also a real person, and the events that happened in the novel is a fictional account of what really happened. In the novel and movie, Joe walks in on the trial of Justine Moritz, where in Mary's novel, she is on trial for the murder of Frankenstein's little brother William, whom was strangled to death and a locket was stolen. A locket that was found on Justine, making her the prime suspect in the murder.
That's a pretty clever idea. The events that happen in Shelley's novel happens in secret. In the Frankenstein universe, the only piece of written record of the monster's existence is letters written by a random sea captain who may or may not even survive his voyage.
The only historical record that would exist would be a woman sentenced to death for the murder of a child, which would then inspire an 18-year-old Mary Godwin to write a story where the woman is instead innocent and framed by a creature created by a mad college dropout he abandoned and now has daddy issues. That's not a bad idea for the setup for an alternative history novel.
Except Frankenstein Unbound makes it stupid.
In Aldous's novel, Mary confesses that she didn't know anything about Victor Frankenstein or his creature. She already has been writing the novel when Joe visits her at Villa Didati at Lake Geneva, where the infamous ghost story bet was made in June of 1816 that Mary began writing her book. It was just a huge coincidence that at the same time of writing her novel, that same exact thing was happening across the lake.
A coincidence or lazy writing?
The movie did try to fix this issue and have Mary be at Justine's trial, and the idea of a monster terrorizing Switzerland and framing Justine was presented to the court, making more sense for a Mary Godwin to think that the monster might be real and Justine really be innocent. Both movie and book have Joe going between Victor and Mary to try and stop Justine's execution together. He tries to convince Victor to come clean about his creature and confesses to Mary about her book, hoping the two can come together and rescue Justine, which does not happen, and Justine is killed about a quarter of the way into the book and movie.
That sucks. What do you do for the rest of the story? That was kind of the central conflict. How about we just fuck around with some historical figures for a couple chapters?
Joe in the book is welcomed with open arms by Lord Byron and everyone at Villa Didati, while his visit in the movie is relatively short. In the novel, everyone enjoys his company as they discuss science, poetry, and philosophy. Percy Shelley and Lord Byron are sharing pieces of poetry that they've been working on in secret to Joe. They talk about what the future holds, which Joe has a bit of an unfair advantage there. All of which Joe is well loved and complimented by these real life historical figures. And then there are very, very long passages of Percy Shelley promoting socialism.
Okay, going into a political talk in post-election 2020, I'm gonna need something a little bit stronger.
The term socialism was first used in print more than a decade after this summer vacation at Lake Geneva, and didn't become a more widespread term till a couple more years after that. On a historical level, it wouldn't make sense that the term be used by these characters at this time period. That being said, much like how Frankenstein is a science fiction novel a decade before the term was first used, the ideas of a social-based co-opted economy and the ideas of classism and class struggle were around at the time, and the idea that Percy Shelley could be retroactively labeled a socialist by political theorists is something that has been discussed for a long time. In 1888, Eleanor Marx, Karl Marx's daughter, wrote an op-ed arguing that through Shelley's poetry, she believes that he would have been a socialist if he lived long enough for the term to be used, pointing out themes used in his writing. Percy Shelley believed in equal rights to women and the struggle between the rich and poor. Through this, she calls him a socialist. However, in 1980, journalist Paul Foote wrote the book Red Shelley, in which he argues that the connections between the poet's writings are too broad for anyone to conclude that without a doubt he was a socialist.
This goes into the death of the author territory, separating the artist from their work, or using their work as a means to understand their views. Percy Shelley's writing did inspire actual communist and socialist philosophers throughout history. That being said, members of some minority groups like and are inspired by the works of H.P. Lovecraft, despite his hang-ups about minority groups. And I'm very late to the game, pointing out that a large group of fans in the LGBTQ+ community and their allies spent a good chunk of this year coping with the views of J.K. Rowling because of what a central part her books were in their adolescence.
In the end, while I think it's a fun exercise to make these different readings to different works, and in doing so may appreciate a work of fiction or nonfiction from a new and different angle, or the opposite, looking back on a piece of work and pointing out faults that someone else may not have noticed, I don't think you can make a concrete conclusion on the author's intent. You can make the argument, but people are people, and we appropriate and contradict ideas all the time. You can probably make anyone out to be anything.
Anyone.
Many, many companies are coming back to our country. They know where the action is. This is where they want to be. Under the previous administration, America's rich natural resources, of which your state has a lot, were put under lock and key.
When the Chinese traders come in, and they come in 20 at a time, they come in all the way. But when the Chinese come in, and they want to make great trade deals, and they make the best trade.
It's the greatest theft in the history of the world.
Nazarove, Tavarish.
Anywho, back to Frankenstein Unbound. After Joe fails to save Justine, there is a rumor that Victor Frankenstein is murdered and Joe becomes the prime suspect, where he's sent to jail awaiting trial. But while in prison, Joe nearly drowns when Lake Geneva floods the city. It's never at all explained if a dam is destroyed or some other reason for the lake to spill over. Joe thinks there are time slips happening all over, causing the disruption.
Through the wreckage, Joe looks at Frankenstein's castle and is relieved to see that there's a light in the upper window, burning bright, guiding like a star no matter what or who you are. There was a light.
Meeting with Victor, Joe finds that he's actually going through with making the creature a wife, something he didn't finish making in the original Frankenstein novel. Joe is met with a hostile Victor, thinking Joe is there to sabotage the creation. He kinda is, but isn't. It's all very confusing. Joe wins Victor's trust when Joe finds out that Victor is actually a huge fan of Percy Shelley, and they just start quoting his poetry together.
So we have a book where a pretty bland main character is whisked away, becomes best friends with interesting historical and fictional characters, surrounded by a bunch of plot threads that just drop throughout and never spoken of again. Is this just Mary Shelley fanfiction?
Oh, Mary, I had to journey 2 centuries to find such a lover, and there never was a love like ours before. Dearest Mary.
Oh, no.
While the movie doesn't have Lake Geneva flooding or Joe being arrested, they did keep Mary and Joe doing the nasty in the pasty. When that's over, he just up and leaves her for the rest of the story. For the rest of the movie and book, Joe is with Victor trying to figure out how to stop him from creating another creature. In the movie, Joe decides to rewire some cables into his car to create another time slip. In the novel, Joe lies in wait with his Browning M1919 machine gun mounted on his car to shoot the happy monster couple when they walk out of the castle.
What? I didn't mention a machine gun casually mounted on the car until now? Well, neither did the f***ing book.
There's this snippet of a theme in the movie adaptation where Joe realizes that he is a modern-day Victor Frankenstein as he uses his machine gun to send him, Victor, and the 2 creatures into another time slip.
What is happening?
Meet my monster.
Because in the novel, Joe doesn't have anything to do with the time slips, we don't have this. As the 2 creatures walk out into the night, Joe has his machine gun at the ready, but instead of firing on the happy couple, he sits and watches them have sex in the moonlight.
So here we have Joe in this other dimension.
With voyeuristic intentions.
Well secluded, he sees it all, and we have to read it all.
Frankenstein Unbound is a disjointed, unfocused, contradictory mess of a story. Joe as a main character is confusing, not out of anything complex, but because his attitudes and motivations throughout the story change on a dime. Even though it's a first-person narrative, I don't understand this man at all. The movie is not much of an improvement, but there is some kind of improvement. Joe notices that he became a modern-day Frankenstein in his drive, same as Victor. The message is a blunt force to the head levels of telling that to the audience.
I am Frankenstein.
The main problem with the movie is that it's boring. You can tell no one wants to be there, making me not want to be there.
This book and movie is astounding. I got so bored it felt like time was fleeting, and madness was just taking control. But everyone should listen closely, and not for very much longer. I just gotta keep my composure. There's so many better works inspired by Frankenstein out there. Instead of these two, I suggest something just a little less nonsensical.
This is CB Smith, and thanks for taking a page. Hey everyone, thanks for watching this last video I made based around Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. Let me know in the comments what other books and adaptations you'd like to see on this channel. I hope everyone is staying safe, and as always, take care.
Why don't you just stay right here? Stay right here. Do you want to come up here? Do you want to be a YouTube star? Aw, hi baby. Do you want some mead? It's mead. It's not whiskey. I don't drink strong shit. So here we have Joe in this other dimension. And